Alright guys, welcome back. So the second question that I received for Q&A via Patreon was about the built-in physics engine in Game Maker. It's taken me quite a long time to sort of decide in my head how I wanted to tackle this subject, because it's kind of a beefy subject and there's a lot that could be talked about. But what I decided to do in the end is to cover physics over a number of videos. So in this one, I'm just going to try and talk about what the physics engine in Game Maker actually does, why you might want to use it, and importantly, why you would not want to use it. And in another short series, we'll be looking at building a simple physics-based game, like a Moonlander game or something where a physics engine would be appropriate. It won't be a platform game though, and that's for reasons that'll become probably obvious later on. This video. So just to clarify here in advance, this video isn't going to really contain much about how to actually use the physics and system in Game Maker. That'll be coming in these future videos where I do this small project, something putting together. But it is very important for you to understand what it means to actually use the physics engine and what it does and what the actual point of using it is. Alright then, so physics. Most types of games my tutorials have covered or looked at so far have at least something in them that resembles or can be loosely described as physics, right? I mean, we have objects and we make them move around and behave in certain ways under certain rules and certain conditions, and that's largely the idea of what physics, or at least, you know, mechanics means, right? So what does it mean when we talk about the physics functions in Game Maker? Well, the physics library in Game Maker, which is based on these open source libraries called Box2D and Liquid Fun, are another way to control the physical behavior of all the objects in your game and their collisions and interactions with other stuff. What we would normally do for a collision scene is react to a collision taking place, or being about to take place, and implement a specific case rule to deal with that specific type of collision. We can decide what happens when you're on the floor, when you're touching a wall, when you're about to hit a wall from a certain side, or at a certain speed, or under other specific conditions, but we have to write cases to deal with all of these. When you have a very, very large number of different objects that all need to react very, very differently to dozens of different arbitrary solutions based on different angles and speeds, just based on whatever your game design happens to be, it becomes clear sometimes that writing case-by-case solutions for your physics isn't really the most effective solution. So this is where GameMaker's physics library comes in handy. Instead of trying to account for every possible physical interaction in your game, the physics system essentially operates more passively on a series of rules that govern your entire game world and how things in that world and universe interact. Meaning all you have to do is define specific properties of an object, like its shape and its weight, and then it's ready to go. It will work in the world. There's a few important things to know about this system, and you can find a lot of this stuff just in the help index for Game Maker, but I think it's important to go through just a couple of these things anyway. So when using the physics engine in Game Maker, it doesn't necessarily cohere to the same timings, room speed, and step event order that everything else does. It's a separate passive system that's working kind of separately to the rest of the logic in your game. And the movements are a bit more abstracted and you generally have less overall control over them. When you're using the physics system, you want it to essentially replace normal movement functions. So instead of setting speed and direction for your objects, you apply forces to that object in order to move it around. If you try and combine this with many of the movement methods from my other tutorials, where X and Y coordinates are set manually, you'll probably run into a lot of problems and confuse the physics engine into sometimes not really knowing where the objects are or where they should be. There's a lot of other caveats and things to note about using the physics system, and as I said, a lot of it is covered in GameMaker's help file, simply on a page under physics, and I really, really recommend reading all of this if you want to try and use this system. We'll probably be talking more about some of the specific things listed here in future videos on physics. What's important here though is to remember that this solution works best for very certain types of games, and while it may seem very convenient to leave the physics in your game up to a system that can handle all different situations for you, it can very, very easily kill a game where such a physics engine simply just doesn't belong. If you're making a platform game, for example, and you want to use the physics library, and your reason for this is pretty much anything at all other than it's essential for the physics-based mechanics and feel of the game about physics that I'm making. You should almost definitely abandon the idea of a physics library and generally work with a more reactive system like the ones I've already covered in previous tutorials. For example, one of the major complaints often thrown at Little Big Planet, a very popular game, is how floaty and arbitrary the platforming in the game actually feels. This is the consequence of using a physics engine in a 2D or rather 2.5D environment where the player wants to actually have some precise control when they're trying to jump over gaps or avoid spikes and obstacles. When you use a physics engine, your interaction with the game is far less digital and precise and is much more analog and abstracted. Instead of, for example, doing something so precise as accelerating at 0.4 pixels a second squared to the left when you press the left key, you're going to move in a calculated vector of some speed or other, sort of leftish, maybe. And this isn't inherently bad, and that's an exaggerated example. You have more control than I'm probably suggesting there. But it's just a very, very different way to handle the movement in your game, and it's going to define a lot of how your game feels and controls, and thusly define quite a lot of what your game is. Back to the example of Little Big Planet, the reason the game uses a physics engine is part of its sandbox and, well, physics-y nature. They wanted players to be able to build and play with physics-based puzzles and have an experience that relates closely to the real-world experience you might have had playing with blocks and toys as a child. The whole aesthetic and theme of the game plays deeply into this, and it's at the core of what the game is really about. But it does mesh a little uncomfortably with the more traditional notion of being a platform game, and it sometimes feels like you don't have that much control and seem to be arbitrarily flailing your way across the stage sometimes, as opposed to carefully avoiding obstacles with precision as you might in a more regular platform game. Anyway, this isn't a review of Little Big Planet or anything. The point I'm trying to get to with all of this is that using a physics engine drastically changes the feel of your game and the amount of direct control you have over movements and collisions. If you want to use it, just make sure that it fits and works for the experience you're trying to build, which should usually be something to do with physics. So that's what the physics engine actually does, and that's why you may or may not want to use it with your games. And as I said, following episodes we'll be looking into actually building something basic using this system so you can get an idea of how to actually implement this stuff in your game. Until then, I'll catch you next time, and hope that was useful.